Let's start with holy water. In nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Pater noster, Alpha Omega, Sator, Repo, Tenet, Opera, Rotas. God the Father, the Most High, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, God of Holy Ghost, of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. All the archangels, Saint Michael, Saint Jophiel, Saint Samuel, Saint Gabriel, Saint Raphael, Saint Uriel, Saint Zedekiel, and all our guardian angels. Hail Kahata Domini, Hail Kahata Domini, Hail Kahata Domini, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee, and all the saints in heaven. Grant me, O Lord, the power to my hands for wiping of all stain, so that without defilement upon mind and body, that I might serve you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Blessed be the Lord my rock, who trained my hands for war, and my fingers for battle. My mercy, my safeguard, my fortress, my stronghold, my deliverer, my shield, in which I take refuge, who subdue people under me. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Pater noster, qui es in celi, sanctificetur nomen tuum, advenia regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo, et in terra. Pater nostrum quotidianum, et nobis odie, et dimitte nobis dimitte nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus territoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, sed libera nos a malo. Amen. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus. Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nun et in hora mortis nostre. Amen. Gloria Patri et Filio, et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat principio, et nun et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. In nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Abba, Sator, our Father, the Almighty, who created heaven and earth. Abba, Sator. In nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Pater noster, Alpha Omega, Sator, Repo, Tenet, Opera, Rotas. Yeshua, Amasya, Sator, Surga, Orgadia. Amen, Amen, Amen. In nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen.
Something special about me, something different about me. that I was unique. Now, the fact of the matter is, you are unique. Every one of us is unique. We are unique, precious, and unrepeatable. I mean, if fingerprints are all different, and they are, and if snowflakes are all different, and they are, persons, people, individuals are so different. You know, St. Thomas Aquinas once taught on the angels. He wrote a very famous theological treatise on the angels. He called it his treatise on separated substances. That when he was referring to angels. And what he was basing his thesis was, he was talking all about angels, that every angel is so different from every other angel as to constitute a separate species unto itself. That's how different the angels are. Now, we're not angels, but we are very high in the hierarchy of being. Every one of us is unique, precious, and unrepeatable. And you can't lose sight of that. And if you have allowed the cynicism and rejection of the world to beat that out of you, take back what's yours. Because you are indeed special. But before you let it, don't let that go to your head. Because the reason you're special is because of God. Well, I had that intuition. And I really had a desire in that moment to make my parents proud of me. I wanted, especially my mother and my father. My father was a hard man. Now, my dad passed away this year. You know, I don't know if y'all know, I buried my dad September 11th. And so I buried my father September 11th. It didn't have anything to do with the tragedies that took place that day. His funeral was September 11th. I flew down to Los Angeles for the funeral. I was going to be the one celebrating the funeral rites. My lady, my office manager, who runs my office, called me up early in the morning and turned on the television, and the rest is history. But I buried my dad September 11th. My dad was a hard man. Now, in his old age, he mellowed out, as we say. But when he was young, he was a hard man, not altogether what he should have been as a husband and a father. But he taught me something. My dad was an athlete, a very good one. He was an excellent athlete. He was one of those extremely physical guys. Now, he was known for being tough. He played a lot of sports, but he was a boxer. And the one thing he taught me, the one thing, maybe that the only thing I can recall that he ever taught me, he probably taught me more than one thing, but the only thing I recall that he really got into my head, don't you dare quit. Don't you dare lay down and quit. Don't you ever throw the fight. And I don't care how bad you're getting beat. So serious about I interiorized that and carried it with me for the rest of my life, although I never thought about it specifically. Well, time went on and I tried to excel in different things, and I had to overcome some handicaps. The biggest handicap I had, and this is the truth, now don't laugh when I say this. The biggest handicap I had to overcome, I was so introverted and shy, I couldn't open my mouth in front of anybody. I would hide. When I had to go to school, I would literally hide so I didn't have to go, especially if I knew I had to recite a lesson or something in school. I was so frightened of that. And a lot of other things. Probably a psychiatrist would have a wonderful time with me. Well, sports presented itself as the thing that would get me out of the rut, like many of the boys in my neighborhood. And it was kind of a rough neighborhood, like I said, it was the old part of town, downtown. And athletics was a way out for a lot of us. And so I began, although I have to say until I was 12, I was too scared to get serious about it. And then when I had just turned 12, my mother brought me up to the local playground. They had every summer, they had a series, they had a playground director, and they had different things that you could do, sports and games. And the playground director that summer was an All-American end on the Boston College football team. And he was one of my better friend's big brother. And my mother dragged me up there by the ear and told that man, said, now, my son is so afraid to do anything, he is so introverted, he is so timid and scared, do something with him, would you? He was a very kind man. He was an African-American man, about 6'4", 250 pounds. And he said, well, he said, how about I show you how to do a push-up? And then he began to show me, he said, well, then he taught me how to box. And his younger brother, who was a good friend of mine, we became the best boxers around. I trained in the same gym that one day Mike Tyson would train in Catskill, New York, where he started. In any event, I began to develop self-confidence, and I thought, maybe this is it. Maybe this is my way to greatness. And I had great hope. Hope is a wonderful thing when you have it in your heart. I went almost all the way to the Golden Gloves, but I didn't. I did not win. There is always somebody bigger, faster, stronger, sooner or later. Well, my hopes were dashed. Funny thing, when you hope in something creative, you set yourself up for disappointment. Time went on. I finished high school. The Vietnam War came. I always loved the military. I just I've just come from a conference last weekend in Virginia. I was in Woodbridge, Virginia last weekend. It's very close to Washington, D.C. It was a very successful conference, a great number of military people there. Actually, there were even admirals and a couple generals there. And I always liked the military. And so I enlisted in the Army at the age of 18. I had a medical deferment back then in the days of the draft. I had a 4F deferment because of a football injury to my shoulder. And that was like a prized possession in those days. Man, I mean, people would have paid $100,000 or more for a 4F deferment if they'd have had it. Well, I didn't want to get out. I enlisted in the Army after rigorous training with the equivalent of a physical or personal trainer, you'd call it today. I didn't pay this guy. He's just a friend. I got in and enlisted with an enlistment commitment for the Special Forces. And having loved, I loved the idea of the military. Now, you know, from when I was a little boy, I do not ever remembering playing anything when I was a boy. I never played anything other than soldier. My favorite toys were guns. Now, I'm telling you all these things. A lot of you don't know me. They say, what that kind of priest is this? Sports, football and boxing, and I only played soldier. Matter of fact, when I was 7 or 8 years old, I remember the only prayer that I ever remember in my life, spontaneous prayer. I remember a little boy, I knelt down to say my prayers before I went to sleep, and I said, oh Lord, please do not let me die like other men in bed. Sick. Oh. I want to go with my boots on. I'd seen me some cowboy movies. And either, you know, cowboy or soldier, but with my boots on in a blaze of glory. Watch out what you ask for. Anyway, I enlisted in the Army, went through all that training. It was in the South. I went in April. And you know what? When you go in the Army in April, you know what's coming? Summer. In the South. I first went to South Carolina, then I went to Alabama, and then I went to Georgia, and then I went to North Carolina. I ate more red dirt in the South. Oh, I remember it. With each succeeding stage of training, it got harder and harder. It didn't get easier, it got harder. They turned up the heat. Forced marches, 30 miles a day through the swamp, full pack, guns. Come in 10, 11 o'clock at night, exhausted, 5 minutes to eat. And you had to do 25 pull-ups before you got in the mess hall. I remember the last 2 weeks of my training, E&E, when I said that, all the Army people, where I was by Washington, D.C. last weekend, they all kind of, I saw the expressions, they all knew what it was, E&E, escape and evasion. Last 2 weeks, night jump, parachute jump into the Okefenokee Swamp. That's the largest swamp in the United States. Wonderful. I really liked it. I have always had more zeal than brains. And then we parachuted into the darkness and landed in a swamp full of alligators and poisonous snakes. We had a topographical map, a compass, a survival knife, length of fishing line with a hook, and we had to go alone, not in groups, alone. And they had a battalion of rangers hunting us, and you didn't want to get caught. I loved it. I loved it. I had always loved the outdoors. I had a big advantage. I wasn't scared of anything out there. And, you know, you got to survive for 2 weeks. So how would you do that? I was talking to a lady who's a retired Navy captain. I met her last week, and she was a pilot and in the Navy. And she had gone through survival school and so forth. And we were comparing notes and laughing. But it was wonderful. I just, you know, slogging through the swamp, trying to keep from getting caught, trying to stay alive. You ever eat a snake? Sound of crying in the barracks at night. Now, this was the days of the draft. A lot of those boys didn't want to be there. They had left their families for the first time. I'd left my family for the first time, too. But I wanted to be there. I wanted to be there. A lot of them didn't want to be there. And they were crying. They left wives, girlfriends, parents. And I remember at night saying, oh, those poor guys, man, I'm glad I'm not like them. I'm happy to be here. I was motivated. You have been motivated about anything, you need to be motivated. You need to have hope. I had a lot of hope. I had the hope that this was it for me, that I had found my place in life, that I was going to make my family, my friends proud. I was going to do something for my country. I had a lot of hope and a lot of motivation. Well, I finished the training. We were on our way to Vietnam. Panama Canal Zone, Jungle Warfare School, helicopter accident. Damaged my shoulder very badly. Lost almost 50% of the use of my right shoulder permanently. They said the rest of my team went to the Central Highlands in Vietnam. I went to a hospital. I was crushed. I was crushed. Everything I worked for. Lost hope. I was deflated. Within 90 days, every last man was dead. My entire team. Every man. God's ways are not always. Well, I finished my tour in the Army. I went to Europe. Had a basically easy job. Was honorably discharged, finished college, went off to work in business. I thought, well, at least maybe I could have a respectable job and make some money. Went to Las Vegas as an accountant. casinos for clients. And we were the only two, my friend and I, were the only two non-Mormons in the firm. And the Mormons are very, very good family people, good wholesome kind of people. They did not want to put their men into casinos to work. They didn't mind taking the fees, but they said, a couple Italians from New York, hey. So we began doing the odds. I had the Las Vegas Hilton, the Flamingo Hilton, the Tropicana. These were my clients. And I began to do well. I met all the movie stars, the rock stars. It was exciting. I was mesmerized by it. I began to do better and better. And I thought, finally, I found it. I had hope again. Hope in my heart. It was great. I was motivated. Wonderful when you have that. Well, one thing led to another. I was hired by one of our clients, the Tropicana. I had a big position at the Tropicana. Then the governor appointed me to the Nevada Gaming Control Board. And that was very exciting. I did investigations all over the country on sources of funds into the casinos. I even went to foreign countries on investigations. And then the election came and the governor didn't get reelected and I didn't get reappointed. And I was part of the unemployment statistics that year. But I didn't lose too much sleep over it. I picked myself right up and I went off to California, where there was a second gold rush going on, real estate boom. So I thought I would use my knowledge of accounting and finance to try to make my fortune that way. And I about starved to death for 2 years. But then it clicked. I used to work hard. When you have hope, when you are motivated, you will work hard. I worked 12 to 18 hours a day, 6, sometimes 7 days a week. Finally, it had to pay off. And very quickly, I was very successful. I remember 1979, I was so successful, my accountant, even though I was an accountant, I had an accountant. After you start making money, even if you're an accountant, you got to hire accountants. Because once you have money, you got to figure out a way to keep it. My accountant said, well, you make too much money, you got to have a tax write-off. So I went out and bought a Ferrari. A nice, shiny red one. Before Magnum P.I. And I remember driving it down Rodeo Drive in Beverly Hills, having thought that I had now arrived. Success. Man, the American dream. I had pursued the American dream and caught up with it. Well, one thing led to another. I began to get more and more prestigious clients, rock stars, movie stars.
Four symbol of the Holy Ghost, dove, fire, water, candlestick lamp, with three candles representing the Holy Trinity. The Holy Ghost is here, the Holy Ghost is here, the Holy Ghost is here, with the Sacred Heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary is here, and the Blessed Candle. Unam Sanctam Catholicam et Apostolicam Iglesiam. 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 One Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. Viva Bigenau. Viva Archbishop Lapin. Long live Bigenau. Please go to Latin Mass and receive the mystical body of Jesus Christ, the continuity of the sacrifice of the mystical body of Jesus Christ, to receive the sanctifying grace and the capital D blessing from the Father, from Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost, and Blessed Mother Mary, the Mother of God. Please, forget the Novus Ordo Mass. Go to the true Church, the mystical body of Jesus Christ, and not to be lied. The gaslighting of the Novus Ordo Mass. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Angel, good morning, Angel. Good morning, I cannot see you, Angel. Angel, bye-bye now, Angel. Bye-bye. Okay. Oh, I cannot see you, Angel. Where are you? Okay, bye-bye. Show your teeth, Angel. Show your teeth. Okay, bye-bye. Smile. Smile, baby. Bye-bye. Angel, where are you? Come on, bye-bye.